Having introduced abstract simplicial complexes and simplicial maps between them, we assigned a geometric realization, a topology corresponding to a simplicial complex. The next task is to convert the simplicial maps between two simplicial complexes into corresponding continuous functions from the geometric realizations. So today's topic is simplicial maps. Start with two simplicial complexes, Ki, with Vi as vertex sets. A simplicial map between K1 to K2 is nothing but a vector, a vertex map, which takes the simplicities of K1 into simplicities of K2. Okay, so once you have such a thing, you want to define a mod phi from mod K1 to mod K2, the geometric realization of K1 and K2. So you can call this mod phi also. It's a geometric realization, it will be a continuous function. So that is the aim. But how to assign? We take the canonical definition, namely, if phi maps several of the vertices to the same vertex, then at that vertex, you take the sum of all the values of alpha, which are mapped onto that vertex. Namely, I have defined mod phi of alpha. Alpha is a function, remember, on the vertex sets. So mod phi of alpha will be a function on the vertex set of K2. So let V2 be a vertex of K2. That means it's inside V2. Mod phi of alpha will be defined as sum of all the alpha V1, where V1 is mapped onto V2. There may be several points which are mapped onto V2 by phi. So take all of them and evaluate them at alpha and take the sum. Okay. So the right hand side here is a real number, a non-negative real number. This sum may be empty also. There may not be any V1 mapped onto V2. This sum may be non-empty, but the sum itself may be zero. For each alpha, V1s may be zero. So that is also possible. But the sum total, we have to see that it is less than or equal to 1. That is important. Is always non-negative, that's fine. If it is bigger than 1, it doesn't make sense. But this cannot be bigger than 1 because all the time it is sum of the vertices evaluated at all by alpha. Alpha evaluated it only sum of the vertices. Even if you evaluate alpha at all the vertices, namely finitely many, the sum total is equal to 1. So this should be always less than or equal to 1. Okay. So as a function, it is well defined. It makes sense. One more thing we have to verify. Namely, when you take mod phi alpha must be a point of mod K2, then its values at all the various points, sum total must be equal to again 1. So if I vary V2 here, then I am going to take all the points inside V1, okay, which are mapped on to various points inside V2, but this sum will be taken over all the V2s. Therefore, all the V1s will be taken care of. Therefore, this summation will become 1. Okay, therefore, this left-hand side is actually well-defined, defines a function from mod k1 to mod k2. Okay, this summation is never infinite by the very argument I have given, because they are only values of alpha taken at various points, various vertices. Moreover, one more thing we have to verify. Look at all the points wherein mod phi alpha is not zero. That is called support of mod phi alpha. This support of mod phi alpha must be a vertex of, must be a simplex of K2. Okay, so why that is true? So we need to have support of mod phi alpha as a member of S2. But this is nothing but phi of support of alpha. Look at all the points wherein alpha is not zero. Only those things will contribute and nothing else. All of them will contribute, of course, because alpha of one of them will be equal to alpha phi of that. So all of them will be taken care. So support of mod phi alpha is actually phi of support of alpha. This is a simplex, and phi is a simplicial map. Therefore, phi of support of alpha is a simplex. Okay, with all these things, mod phi is well defined. Okay, essentially you have to think of this as summing up the coordinates. So if we are working with product topology, automatically this will be a continuous function, right? But we are not working product topology. What we are working with is this weak topology. We have to verify that it is continuous. Okay, but verifying continuity is easier in the case of weak topology. Okay, restricted to any closed simplex F. Okay, mod phi is actually a linear map, affine linear map. When I say linear here, it's affine linear, namely mod phi operating upon T times alpha plus 1 minus T times beta, where alpha and beta are elements of this closed simplex. Therefore, this convex combination makes sense. That will be also an element of closed simplex. Mod phi of that is T times mod phi of alpha plus 1 minus T times mod phi of beta. Can you see why? Because mod phi of whatever left hand side operating upon a vertex V, okay, is taken by the definition, it is this function operating upon, see, you can see what, go back to this definition, operating upon a vertex is the left hand side, this alpha, operating upon vertices which are mapped onto that, right? So this is operating upon some V2, and then you are taking sum. But before taking the sum, you can pull out this T, it's T times alpha V2 plus 1 minus T times beta V2. Then you are taking the sum, so T and 1 minus T will come out of respective things, leaving mod phi of alpha and mod phi of beta in the integer. So this linearity is very easy to verify. Okay, so if you restrict mod phi to closed simplex F, it is continuous because it is affine linear. Okay, since this is true for every mod F, okay, where F ranges over all the simplexes of K, that is even for continuity from mod K1 to mod K2. This is one of the criterion for continuity. That's the definition of the weak topology on mod K1. Okay. So we are successful defining mod of phi for each simplicial map phi from K1 to K2. Okay. This is in each chunk of simplexes, on a triangle, on a line, on a tetrahedron, and so on, it will be linear, only affine linear. Okay. There is no origin for all of them. So this is what is going to be what we are going to say, you know, unifying the concept of linear approximation now. So we have generalized the linear map, which is very rigid. Okay. So now we can cut down one linear map in a small portion, another linear, and so combination of linear. So this is what is going to happen with this one. So in some sense, you can think of this mod phi as a linear map. Okay. All simplicial maps give back on mod k, on the geometric realization, something like a linear map. Especially, they will be continuous also. Another interesting thing here is that under composition, this mod is compatible. Namely, first you take phi and then follow it by psi. These two are simplicial maps, you get psi composite phi. If you take the mod of that, it is modulus of psi composite modulus of phi. And modulus of the identity is identity, that's very clear, because look at this definition here. If phi is identity map, then alpha v1 will be v1. Okay, there is no summation, nothing. So p of alpha will be just alpha, right? Similarly, if you take another psi on this one, okay, phi mod phi, okay, if you take another composite psi of that, by very definition, if psi of this one you have to take, then psi of alpha, mod psi of alpha is again you have to take the similar definition. So it will be the composite term. So composition is also not difficult to verify. There are finite summation. You can interchange the summation also if you like. There is no need to do that. But you can say that the total summation is the same thing as once you take this summation and other summation. So composition is also not difficult to verify. Okay.
Hello, sir. Like for phi map, where simplex is mapped to simplex, is it same happening with mod phi too?
Mod phi is going to geometric simplex. It's going to be inside geometric simplex. Mod f, you have to take bracket f, closure f of f. It will go to phi f, closure. It will go inside that. That's all. That's what we have verified. Okay. Support of phi alpha, okay. This will tell you, this precisely tells you that, no? Restricted to each simplex, it is inside, taking inside that one. Support doesn't go out of that. Phi of support, this tells you the story. Support of mod phi alpha is phi of support of alpha. Phi of support of alpha, if support of alpha is f, then phi of support of alpha is phi f. It's all. That's a simplex. What you may have is, here you may have an edge, there may have just a vertex, because both the vertices of the edge might have mapped to the same point. Here you may have a tetrahedron, there you may have a triangle only. If you have an edge here, it will not, the image will not be a tetrahedron, because there are only two elements. No, function, saturated function, will take only smaller number of points, if at all. At most that many. These are all finite sets, right? Phi of any of those that,
yes,
will have at most that many elements. But it is a simplex in the other simplicial complex, K1 and K2. Of course, K1 and K2 may be the same also. That is why we can talk about the identity map. Identity map is automatically a simplicial map. Now, we go ahead, what we do with simplicial maps and so on, by a triangulation of a topological space, we mean a pair, a simplicial complex, K is a simplicial complex, and F is a homeomorphism from mod K to X. Okay. You start with a topological space X. It has no structure of a simplicial complex or anything. All right. But K is a simplicial complex and mod K is a topological space. F to mod K is a, F from mod K to X is a homeomorphism. This is the definition of a triangulation. The word triangulation is borrowed from when you take a surface, you cut it into triangles. But now we can use it for one dimension, zero dimension, n dimension, 50 dimension, all of them. The word is only triangulation. There you don't see triangles. If you go to three dimension, there will be tetrahedrons and so on. Okay. If X has similar in measure theory, you call the time call volume. A two-dimensional volume is area. One-dimensional volume is length, but we don't have many words, so four-dimensional, five-dimensional, we just take volume. It is just like that. So if we select a specific triangulation on it, then we call it a simplicial polyhedron. Okay. There may be several triangulations for a given topological space, or there may not be any. If there is one, it is triangulable. If you fix one, then it's called a triangulated manifold or triangulated space or a simplicial polyhedron. Sometimes just polyhedron. Okay, so don't confuse this polyhedron. It's a convex polyhedron inside Rn. Convex polyhedron is a special case of a polyhedron, that's all. Now we will have some examples here. One by one, okay. Recall that the join of two topological spaces was defined as the quotient of x cross I cross y, wherein x cross 0 cross arbitrary y1 was identified with x cross 0 cross y2, y1, y2 varying over y. Similarly, on the other end, x cross 1, x1 cross 1 cross y was identified to x2 cross 1 cross y, x1 and x2 varying, y is kept fixed. So this was the definition of what? Of the topological join of x and y, right? And we had also defined the join of two simplicial complexes. So these two are not accidental. There is a close relation between them. So if K1 and K2 are any two simplicial complexes, then the mod of K1 star K2, the join of K1 and K2, is homeomorphic to mod K1 star mod K2. Okay, K1 is a polyhedron, K2 is a polyhedron, I mean mod K1. K1 star K2, you don't know whether it is a polyhedron. Not only it is a polyhedron, it is triangulated by just K1 star K2. Mod of K1 star K2 is homeomorphic to this, is the conclusion here. Indeed, this homeomorphism is such that, remember, both K1 and K2, mod K1 and K2 are subspaces of this join. And here, K1 and K2 are subcomplexes of K1 star K2. Therefore, here also mod K1 and mod K2 will be subcomplexes of mod K1 star K2. Under this homeomorphism, these subspaces are mapped to the corresponding spaces. So that will be easy. That will follow by just looking at the homeomorphism that you are constructing. Okay. So what do? We construct the map at the mother level. So this is the left hand side. Remember, what we have is K1 star K2. I am defining map from mod K1 star K2 to mod K1 star K2. So this is a quotient space of mod K1 cross I cross mod K2. So instead of defining it on the join, I am defining a map on the mother itself. Then I verifying that it factors down to the quotient. This is the way continuous functions are defined on quotient spaces. Okay, so how do we define this one? An element of this, remember, can be thought of as a line from a point here and a point there, line segment, right? So a point alpha and a point beta and a point this some value t. So this is a product, right? There is some identifications later on. So I am not going to use identification. I am directly taking the product. Assign it to 1 minus t times alpha plus t times beta, which is finally supposed to be the line segment. That is why I am defining it like that. Now, alpha and beta, what are they? T 1 minus t times alpha plus t times beta should make sense here, right? Right? So how does it this make sense here? Alpha and beta are functions from vertex set V1, alpha vertex set V1 to I, this vertex set V2 to I. Remember, K1 star K2 was defined as disjoint vertex set of K1 star K2 is a disjoint union of vertices of K1 and K2, V1 and V2, for example. Therefore, alpha, which is a function on V1 and beta is function of V2, makes sense provided you think of this as 0 on the rest of the coordinates. That is the meaning of this. On V2, definitely it is 0. This will be 0 on V1. Inside V1, whatever definition is there, you take that. Here definition, you take that. Now you 1 minus t times alpha plus t times beta makes sense is what you have to see. Okay. So, first of all, you have to see that if I put t equal to 0, okay, then beta is not at all coming into picture. And this t is 1, this will be alpha. Similarly, if t is 1, then alpha doesn't come into picture. This will be just beta. Therefore, the very definition of this identification makes that mod phi, this phi defines a factors through a continuous function from phi twiddle, namely phi twiddle from mod k1 star k2 to mod k1 k2. Okay, so definition is fine. Now we have to verify that it is a bijection, continuous, the inverse is a bijection. Okay, the bijection is already taken care of by the very fact, by the expression here, what is the meaning of expression on this side. Okay, here you must remember that symplexes here are just disjoint union of symplexes here and symplexes there, right? So modulus of those symplexes are just nothing but points of this way, and then you have to take 1 minus t times this plus 1 minus t times that. Some total has to be 1. That's why you have to take, cut it down by, say, 1 minus t plus t, then you take the sum. Okay, so there is a map. Let us see why this is a continuous bijection. Suppose fj, F1 is K1, inside K1, F2 inside K2 are some faces. Then restrict the entire thing to just these faces. Okay. The image never goes out of that in the definition. So let us look at phi hat, phi twiddle from mod F1 star mod F2. This will be subspace of mod K1 star mod K2, right? To F1 star F2 mod. which is nothing but disjoint union of F1 and F2 mod. Okay, now remember, this is a full simplex. Okay, this and all the subsets of this one will be there inside K1 star K2. All right, how many elements are there here? Cardinality of F1 plus cardinality of F2. How many are there here? They are also exactly same. And this map is nothing but, you know, this is automatically an isomorphism. In this picture, which is nothing but, you know, it is 1 minus t times alpha plus t times beta will dilute all the elements here. So every element here can be broken up into an element here plus element here. The element terms inside, there may be zero also, doesn't matter. 0 times 1 minus t times 0 plus t times this one, when you take, it is nothing but all the functions here. That's what it gives you. So this is a homeomorphism. Okay, so here you can directly verify that this is actually a linear, affine linear isomorphism. Okay, from this one, automatically everything follows. Okay, why? Because if you look at the interior of these things, they are not going to intersect each other. So the bijection on the boundary will be bijection on the boundary, from boundary to boundary, interior interior. So on the union also it will be a bijection. The second point is easier, namely continuity of the entire thing is verified by continuity restricting to each simplex, and simplexes are like this. So there it's continuous. Therefore, it's continuous on K1 mod K1 star mod K2. The converse also for continuity on from this way the inverse, again the same thing on F1 disjoint in F2, where F1 and F2 we range over all of them. If you verify the continuity restricted to that, then it will be continuous from K1 star K2 modulus to the mod K1 star mod K2, the inverse map. Okay. So inverse continuity is also verified by this homeomorphism. Therefore, the simplicial joint corresponds to topological joint when you take the geometric realization. So that is the meaning of this. And this fee today is very canonical way we have obtained. See, there is no other structure here. It is just the structure of these, intrinsic structure of these two things are used. So this will automatically give you K1 star, K2 star, K3, all of them associated with our K1 star, K2, K2 star, K1. Okay. So this is a, what you call as canonical bijection, homeomorphism. Under a simplicial map, if K1 to K2, there is a simplicial map, K2 to K3, then you go there, corresponding simplicial map, there will be a commutative diagram under these homeomorphisms. This is the so generic thing, but when you specialize, you can take K anything, but K to second one, you take a single point. Then by definition, K star V is nothing but the cone over K. First take the cone over K and then take the geometric realization. The same thing as take the geometric realization and then take the cone over K. Okay. So this one is a cone over a simplicial complex K, is in fact the topological cone over mod K. All right, because it will be K star mod K star V. Star with a single point space in the case of topological join is just a cone. That is also we have seen. In particular, K star V mod is contractible. Okay. Similarly, if you take X star 2 points, S naught has 2 points, right? This is the suspension we have defined. Right? So you can take K star 2 points here and then take the modulus that will correspond to suspension of K. Okay. So this also, this part we have already seen. Repeated application of S naught star gives you N plus S1. So N plus 1 copies will give you Sn. So this is the whole thing. In particular, if you start with some simplicial complex K such that geometric realization of that is a sphere of some dimension, SPJ, let us say, then if you take the join of these two, then take the geometric realization, it will do the same thing as join of the two spheres, corresponding sphere P1 and P2, which will be equal to S P1 plus P2 plus 1. So this is what we have seen, join of these two. So this is a special case of this one. So we can use many special cases to derive various results from this join. So let us say some more examples, simpler example now. The convex hull of our E0, E1, En inside R infinity is easily seen to be geometric realization of standard simplest delta N. That's what we have seen actually by definition. We shall now use symbol now mod delta N for both of them, whether it is inside Rn plus 1, Rn plus 2, or Rn plus 3, or R infinity, we will use the same symbol mod delta N, okay, for the geometric realization, the standard N simplex. All spheres and disks are triangulable. It means what? There is a polyhedron, there is a simplicial complex. Mod of that simplicial complex will be isomorphic to these spaces. Okay, so what are these? Suppose n is 0. What is d naught? D naught is a single point. What is s naught? S naught is 2 points. So there is nothing to prove there. So singleton, double turn, they are triangulable. All right. The simplest polyhedron is mod f for any q simplex f, which is, if its dimension is q, it is homeomorphic to delta n mod delta q. That is what we have seen, right? So we have been telling that this mod f is homeomorphic to the unit disk dq inside rq. Okay, so just to recall all these things, I will tell you how we have done it. Namely, start with a set of vertices v0, v1, vq for f. An element of mod f is described by describing its coordinate functions, values of the coordinate, alpha naught, alpha 1, alpha q, right? It's a function from this set into I, such that sum of alpha i's is equal to 1, right? Where each alpha is nothing but alpha of vi. Thus, mod f is a subspace of I raised to q plus 1 elements here, consists of elements alpha naught alpha q with summation alpha is equal to 1. Okay, you can see that it is a convex hull of, if you take v naught v1 vq corresponding to e naught e1 eq. Okay, rotate through an angle pi by 4. This will be having a pi, it will make pi by 4 angle with the x axis, or x1 axis, x0 axis, whatever, rotate it so that it will be contained inside some horizontal plane RQ cross T. Okay. Next, choose the origin at the barycenter of mod f. What is barycenter of mod f? It is v0 plus v1 plus vq divided by q plus 1. You think of that as origin. then you take x going to x by mod x by norm x to get a homeomorphism of the boundary faces, union of all the boundary faces to the round sphere sq minus 1, which x by norm x is modulus 1, right? So here is a picture. This is a triangle. Then you can say this one is E naught, E1, E2, and the span of that, which triangle is making 45 degrees. You rotate it, bring this point to the xy plane, the 0, 0, 1 xy plane by rotating it. Rotation, because I don't want to change its geometry, just for a while. So then this has become horizontal in the horizontal plane. You choose the orthocenter or barycenter as the origin. Then you take x by norm x, project it. All of them, this boundary of this triangle goes to the sphere homeomorphically. This is just like a projection map. Okay. Once you have a homeomorphism of the boundary to this one, you can use the so-called cone construction to say that the full disk is homeomorphic to the full simplex. So I will describe that one. So this is what is going to happen. Triangulation of the pair. This is supposed to be the full disk DQ and the boundary simultaneously of the pair gets triangulated. Triangulation means now what? You have a simplicial complex. The boundary of simplicial complex giving you, when you take mod, respectively, they will be DQ and SQ minus 1. Okay. So I will describe this cone construction once for all. Again and again, this will come. Remember, the boundary of F is nothing but all the simplices except F itself. Okay. So this, I want to say that this is going to give you SQ minus 1. So this part we have seen. Now you take the cone over this. That is going to be back. It's same thing as F. It's going to give you F back when you take modulus. Okay. If you take the cone over F, see, for each subset of F, you add the extra point. So that will give you the full set F. The maximum set F, say one subset, one point was missing, the cone will come there and it will be the full set. So this is one way of looking at the boundary of BF. The cone over that one is homeomorphic to again mod F. Modulus of BF is homeomorphic. So this is what you have to use on both sides now. So this is what I am playing. Now, appeal to the following fact. Simplicial complex F is isomorphic to star of, this is the star, a single point, is a cone. This is the join of the single point and BF. Therefore, mod F is homeomorphic to the cone over BF. I take BF and take the modulus of that and then quote, take the cone. First you take the modulus or take the, first take the cone or then modulus. These give you the same thing, which is in turn homeomorphic to the cone, which again is homeomorphic to the full disk. This was also we have seen. The cone over any sphere is homeomorphic to the disk. Okay. Okay, let us stop here.